King of Worshipers! Where's all of my praises? I want everybody around the world to put your hands together because all the praise belongs to God. Here we go.
Praise the Lord this morning, for God truly is good and he's worthy to be praised. And we want to say good morning to everyone, and we welcome you to the Word of God Baptist Church's Sunday morning service, March 29, 2020. And truly it is good to be in the house of the Lord one more time. And so as we prepare ourselves to come and praise and worship the Lord, we're going to begin our service today by our call to worship by Reverend Anthony Caldwell. He will also give us our scripture and prayer of invocation, followed by our pastoral comments by our pastor. Amen.
Our call to worship. The earth is the Lord's, and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. For he hath founded it upon the seas, and established it upon the flood. Yes. Who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord, or who shall stand in his holy place? Yes. He that have clean hands and a pure heart, yes, who have not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord, yes, and righteousness from the God of his salvation. This is the generation of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Yes. Lift up your heads, O ye gates, and be ye lift up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O ye gates. Even lift them up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory shall come in. Who is this King of glory? Who is this King of glory? Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. Our scripture reading will come from the Old Testament prophet of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 28 through 31. Here we find these words. Hast thou not known? Hast thou not heard that the everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, fainteth not, neither is weary? There is no searching of his understanding. For he giveth power to the faint, and to them that have no might, he increaseth strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young man shall utterly fall. But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Thus ends the reading of the word of God. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the word of God shall stand forever. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we come. Thank you for this day and another opportunity to worship you in spirit and truth. And Father, we thank you for life and health and strength on today. We realize that so many lie down last night with the intentions on rising this morning, but have opened their eyes into the ultimate reality. So we thank you, Lord, for life. And we thank you for this opportunity to worship you, So, Father, we admit that we can't even worship you without your help. So we pray now that you would allow your Holy Spirit to manifest himself in our presence. Allow him to lead us into all truth, to comfort us and to guide us and to illuminate your word so that we may understand and become better vessels for your usage. Lord, this is your service and this is your day, and we commend it into thy hands. Have your way in this place and have your way in our hearts. This is your service. Take control. We surrender our wills and our way to you. Speak now, for thy servants are listening. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, heavenly dove. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, heavenly dove. Rest, rule, and abide. This is our prayer. In the name of Jesus Christ, we say thank you. Amen, amen, and amen.
Certainly to our ministerial staff, to Pastor Hawkins, to Brother Cardwell, to all of us who are gathered here today, and certainly to those of us who are listening via social media. We bring greetings on behalf of the Word of God Church. We first want to just share our gratitude to the Community Bible Baptist Church and its Pastor Clevester Wimbish for allowing us to utilize his facility for this service. This is the day that the Lord hath made, and certainly we will rejoice and be glad in it. Before we get started, I just wanted to commend our staff for the leadership that you are showing during these difficult times. We certainly thank God for our administration, our administrative department, and for our chairperson of trustees, Sister Hawkins, for all the work that they are doing. We also want to commend Brother Maurice Cobb and Brother Shawabe Mitchell and Tyrone Duckett for their work in the technical area. We're just so grateful that we have so many committed and dedicated persons who are sharing with us and allowing these services to go forth. We do want to remind all of our members to remain prayerful. Do not panic, because during these difficult times, we know that the enemy plays mind games with all of us. Sometimes we can become psychosomatic in our response, and therefore we will begin to experience symptoms that are not real. But we're encouraging you to just hold on to your faith. And certainly to our young people in particular, we want to share with you and encourage you to continue to to admonish this issue of social distancing, for it is real. We know that the president's staff has indicated that if we are going to get through this particular situation successfully, then it's going to depend in a great deal or to a great deal on our young people. So therefore, you may not know the danger you're putting your parents and grandparents in by not observing these social distancing codes, but we're encouraging you to do so. And we certainly want to encourage all of our young people who at this time have not had an opportunity to involve yourselves in your senior programs, in your senior proms, or in your senior trips. We know how difficult it is, but we know that these days will not continue, and so we're encouraging each of us to remember that tough times don't last, but tough people do. And so we're encouraging each of us to let's be cooperative. We also wanted to indicate and wanted to share with our family, the Word of God Church, that we will not be having a Palm Sunday service or an Easter Sunday service at our facility. We do not want to endanger the membership of Word of God. Of course, you are our greatest asset, and so therefore we're not going to endanger you in spite of what the president says. We're going to continue to do our services in this manner, and we're encouraging all of us to observe all of those rules and regulations that are set in place that are designed to get us through this crisis. In the area of good news, and we have good news on today, most of us may not know, but Sister Stacy Cobb Smith is now Judge Stacy Cobb Smith. She was sworn in, I believe, on Thursday, and all of us are still rejoicing. Most of us don't realize the difficulty it is in attaining such a position, but we are so proud of Stacy, and we're encouraging each of us to text her and to share with her just how proud we are of her. So we just thank God for this opportunity to share. We thank God for the message that we're going to hear today. Our messenger will be officially introduced by her husband in just a few minutes, but we thank God for her consenting to come. And we thank God for not only a fine ministerial staff, but our young ministerial staff are stepping up and doing an excellent job, and we're just so proud of them. We were so proud of Eric on last week, and we're looking forward to a grand time here today. So let us just sit back and enjoy ourselves. At this time, we'll have the daily bread, and then we're going to have the presentation of our preacher by her beloved husband. So let's move on as quickly as we possibly can. God bless you, and may heaven smile richly upon you.
Good morning. Our daily bread for this morning is actually the daily bread for this morning, Sunday, March the 29th, 2020. It was written by Patricia Raybon, and it is entitled Fruit Juice. She used as her foundational passage of scripture John chapter 15, verses 5 through 8, which is a very familiar passage to us all, for it is the greatest parable of Jesus, which is the parable of the vine and the branches. Now, I chose this particular daily bread because of the message. In this daily bread, the message was critical to our growth and development as believers in Christ Jesus. For Patricia Raybon, Bond was trying to relay the importance of being connected and staying connected to God, who is our power source. She began the daily bread with sharing a story of her experience shopping at a consignment store. Now, a consignment store, for those of us in the African-American culture, is called the thrift store. So she was shopping in the thrift store, and while she was shopping, she found what she called the perfect lamp. The lamp was perfect because it was the perfect size, it was the perfect color, and because she was shopping in the thrift store, it was the perfect price. So excited about her precious find, she went and she paid and rushed home. And when she got home, she cleaned up the lamp. She put a bulb in the lamp. She put it on the desk and plugged it into the power source. And she pulled the chain to turn it on. And much to her disappointment, the perfect lamp did not work. So she went to her troubleshooting. She changed the light bulb, and she wiggled the cord, and she even took the lamp into the kitchen and tried plugging it into another wall socket. And she pulled the on and off switch again, and much to her disappointment, the perfect lamp did not work. So she said to herself, "Man, I thought this was the perfect lamp, but it seems like this lamp is the more of an imperfect lamp." So frustrated, she decided she was just going to throw it in the trash. But before doing so, her husband came in and said, "Let me take a look at the lamp. It has everything it needs to work. It has a cord, it has a light bulb, and it has a power source. So it has to be something else going on. And he went and he got his toolbox, and he took the lamp apart, and when he took it apart, he saw exactly what was going on with the lamp. The lamp had become disconnected at the base. So he just threaded the wires together and put a little electrical tape on it, put it back together, plugged it in, and voila, the lamp came on. So he rushed out, and his wife said, How did you get the lamp working? He said it was easy. It was just disconnected at the base. Now I'm pretty sure that some of you are wondering, okay, Reverend Caldwell, that was a nice story and all, but what is the point? Well, here is the point. Are you connected? Or are you like this lamp in our story, disconnected at the base? We have to realize that when we surrender our lives to God, when we gave our life to Him, He transposed us into lamps. And our desire and design is to shine like lamps. He's given us everything we need to do our job. He's given us a cord, which gives us direct access to Him. He's given us a light bulb in the form of our gifts and our talents. And He has even given us an on and off switch in the person of the Holy Spirit. So we have everything in us to do the job that God has designed us to do, which is to shine. So the question is, are you shining? When you pray, is there power in your prayer? Does God answer your prayer? When you are at work and all calamity is breaking out, when you speak, do you cause more fire to the flame, or do you put it out with a sense of calm? Are you shining? If you are not, while you are at home, quarantined, while you're at home, away from the rat race and able to be still, while you're at home, social distancing, if you're not shining, I recommend, Patricia recommends, that you get down on your knees and you pray that the Lord will dismantle your life, that you may be able to see where you're disconnected, so that you can thread up your wire and become connected to God. Because without Him, we cannot do the work that He has designed us to do. For the Bible tells us to let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father which is in heaven. Be connected and stay connected. May God bless you and heaven smile richly upon you.
Amen. Good morning. Excuse me. Good morning, Word of God. I have the honor and privilege to present the preacher of the hour, which happens to be my wife, Reverend Melanie Gilliam. First, giving all honor and praise to my Savior, Lord Jesus Christ, recognizing the pastor of this fine branch of Zion, Dr. Wimbish, and to our own pastor, Reverend Dr. John L. McCoy. It's not a hard or difficult task. I felt like I counted joy and privilege to introduce her. She is what you might call a phenomenal and virtuous woman. She is a wife, she's a mother, she's a daughter, she's a sister, friend, cousin, whatever you, in capacity that you need her to be, that's what Melanie is, or Reverend Gilliam is. She is a joy. She's a gift. I think the body, wherever she puts her feet to the fire, wherever she stakes her claim, it is whoever is the beneficiary is all the better for her being in their presence. I call her the quiet assassin because she doesn't raise her voice that much when she preaches, but after you're finished, you feel like she's carved you up, your feet, your knees, and all those, but in a good way. makes us think, makes us ponder, makes us wonder, what are we doing that'll help us to be better Christians, to be better on the wall for Christ. I always say, and I'll leave it at this, she's the greatest blessing God has ever given me. And I know that other folks say, well, isn't salvation? And I said, well, salvation is given to all of us. But Melanie was given to me specifically. So she's the greatest gift God has given me. So the next voice you will hear is that of Melanie, of Reverend Melanie C. Gilliam. Hear ye her.
Sometimes I feel like giving up. It seems like my best just ain't good enough. Lord, if you hear me, I'm calling you. Do you see, do you care all about what I'm going through? And then he said, one more day, one more step. See, I'm preparing you for myself. And when you can't hear my voice, please trust my plan. I'm the Lord, I see, and yes, I understand. Sometimes I feel like I'm all alone. I'm just like a stranger so far from home. I feel like I've done all that I can do. Please, Lord, give me strength. I'm just trying to make it through. That's when he told me,
good morning, Word of God. Giving all praises to God, recognizing Pastor McCoy, the ministers and leaders of the Word of God Baptist Church, my husband, Reverend Dwayne Gilliam Sr., my family, church family, and all who may be watching and or listening via the many avenues of modern technology. We in the body of Christ are living witnesses, especially during these times, that where two or three are gathered together, touching and agreeing that the Lord is still in the midst. Our text today for this message will be coming from one passage of scripture as recorded by the prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 41:10. Isaiah, the 41st chapter and the 10th verse, which reads, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." And the title of this message for this morning, in such a time as this, is keep the faith. Keep the faith. We are at the end of only the third month in a brand new year. Many of us have come through some painful situations of 2019, financial struggles, health challenges, loss of jobs, and loss of loved ones. And we look so forward to the dawn of a new year, to leave the pain of 2019 behind, only for some of us to walk into 2020 and be faced with heart-wrenching pain, struggles, and circumstances. More health challenges, the loss of more loved ones, disappointments, and now being faced with this health crisis pandemic. Our nation, our entire world is in a state of an unbelievable, unimaginable, unfathomed global crisis that most of us would never have imagined would even be possible. We are facing unprecedented times right now. The world is in a high panic mode as the number of positive COVID-19 cases seem to be on a daily rise. People standing in long lines at local stores buying weeks' worth of food, cases of bottled water, toilet paper, paper towels, hand sanitizer and soaps, disinfectant wipes and sprays, gloves and masks. Many people have been spun into a paranoia about coronavirus by the media. Some of that fear is justified, and some of it produces excess anxiety that hurts more than it helps. People are panicking in fear that they might get the virus or that they might have been exposed to someone who may have it. With every cough, sniffle, sneeze, whether from ourselves or someone around us, at the local store or even in our very homes, we may jump, move away, our hearts may skip a beat, we may cast a funny look or even make a comment, or if nothing else, we secretly wonder. Many of us might be afraid about the economic status of ourselves and our families. Pastors and other spiritual leaders might be concerned about the economic status of the church because of the economic status of the family. Now, there is nothing wrong with being concerned. We need to be concerned and we need to be cautious. We need to follow all the safety precautions given by the CDC, all of the rules and guidelines mandated by our leaders and officials. We need to be prepared for the economic state of our families and our churches. Yes, we need to be concerned, but we don't need to be fearful to the point where it overtakes us or grips us when it becomes a spirit of fear. For God told us in his word that he has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And sometimes instead of allowing faith to guide us, we allow fear to consume us. But in a time such as this, when the world seems to be crumbling all around us, when panic, anxiety, stress, and fear seem to be at an all-time high, when we are struggling to comprehend what's going on, to try not to focus on the true and the false reports that we are hearing, when it appears that things are seemingly getting worse before they get better, we need help as never before from an almighty God to help us to hold on to his unchanging hand. In the midst of all the chaos, calamity, and confusion, in the midst of the pain, perplexities, and problems we have faced and are facing, in the midst of the disappointment, distress, and even delay, we don't have to wonder where God is in the midst of all of this. Why? Because he is omnipresent. He is everywhere. We don't have to worry if he hears our prayers, sees our tears, is concerned or knows about what we're going through. Why? Because he is omniscient. He knows everything. We don't have to worry if he can fix it because he is omnipotent. He has all power. So all we have to do is keep the faith. I believe that sometimes what we call faith today is not really faith in God, but it is faith in our circumstances. When our lives are going well, when we're happy, healthy, financially secure, our faith and religious experience is often strong. However, sometimes when we're going through, I said sometimes when we're going through, when we have to wait, when things aren't going the way we expected, when we've prayed and it doesn't seem like our prayers have been answered, or at least not the way we wanted them to be, when we are suffering, when the trials, hardships, and pain come our way, our faith sometimes falters, weakens, or even disappears. When the sun hides behind the clouds, when evil seems to win the day and steal every last glimmer of hope, when our troubles are building upon each other, will we cling to God during those times, or will we turn away? Lord, help me to keep the faith. So how do we keep the faith in a world that seems to be losing it? How do we keep the faith when it seems that all hope is gone? We have to remember. Remember God's protection. Remember God's provision. Remember God's promises. Remember God's power, and remember to give God the praise. As humans, we sometimes want to see God's protection as a magical force that keeps us from all harm. Yes, God can prevent any evil or destruction, but we must remember that God has a permissive will in which he allows some things to happen. Things that we don't understand, because his ways are not our ways. Sometimes God's protection can come in the form of peace and strength in the middle of despair. Sometimes his protection can come in the form of protecting our hearts and minds as we go through whatever it is he may allow. I cannot always explain or even comprehend the ways of God. But what I do know is that he is a protector and that he is a keeper. David penned God's protection and his keeping power so beautifully and powerfully in Psalm 91 when he said, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and fortress. My God, in him will I trust." Keep the faith. Surely he will deliver thee from the snare of the fowler and from the noisome pestilence. He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. Keep the faith. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid for the terror by night, nor for the arrow that flieth by day, nor for the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor for the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at thy side and 10,000 at thy right hand, but they shall not come nigh thee. Only with thine eyes shall thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is my refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. There shall no evil befall thee, neither shall any plague come nigh thy dwelling. We are in the arms of God. He will protect us. We just have to keep the faith. Next, we must remember God's provision. Despite the chaos that might be going on in our personal lives right now, or the chaos that may be going on in the world, God has been good. And every now and then, especially during times like these, when my faith may get a little shaky, the Lord has to remind me, haven't I been good to you? Haven't I provided for you? Haven't I made ways out of no ways? Didn't I tell you that I would supply all your need according to my riches and glory? I have been, am right now, and will continue to be Jehovah Jireh, God your provider. So you just have to keep the faith. Do you know that God already has provisions for prayers we haven't even prayed yet? I said God already has provisions for prayers that we haven't even prayed yet. That because he is omniscient, all-knowing, he already knows what's ahead. And because he is omnipotent, all-powerful, he has already made a way for what's to come that we don't even know about. God tells us in Matthew 6:30-34a, "Wherefore, if God so clothe the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, and what shall we drink, or wherewithal we shall be clothed? For after these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow shall take thought of the things of itself. We must remember that if he brought us out of that on yesterday, that he can surely bring us out of this on today. So despite our chaotic circumstances, our attitudes need to be a profound proclamation that Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. That he saw my need on yesterday and he provided. And he sees my need today and he is providing. So I need not worry about tomorrow, for I know he will provide. So we just have to keep the faith. Remembering God's promises. Saints, we must stand on the promises of God as never before. There are over 7,000 promises in God's word. And with that many promises, we can be assured that there's one to fit each situation in which we might find ourselves. God promised that he would never leave us nor forsake us. He promised to be with us always, even until the end of the world. In God's promises, we find hope. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. As we grow in Christ, there exists within us a faith that grows. It is beyond just believing. It has to be a way of life. Sometimes it seems when we grow weary, we can become faithless. And in these moments, we must remember God's promises, that he loves us, that he is right there with us, and that he will never, ever leave us. So, Lord, you promised to keep me in perfect peace if I keep my mind stayed on you. You promised to perfect that which concerneth us. You promised to restore the years that the locusts have eaten. And whatsoever he promised, he is also able to perform. So keep the faith. Hebrews 10:23 says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promise. Remembering God's protection, remembering God's provision, remembering God's promise, and now we must remember God's power. We mustn't forget that especially during the storms of our lives, that God is still on the throne. When things seem to be out of control, we must keep the faith and remember that God is in control. He has the power to do exceedingly above all that we ask or even think. And while we're trying to figure it out, God is already working it out. It's not so much the how he's going to do it, but more in the fact that he is going to do it. There are those who exist to try to discredit the power of God. However, throughout every page of God's word, his sovereign power is manifested. Concerning a barren Sarah conceiving Isaac, the Lord asked her husband Abraham a rhetorical question in Genesis 18:14. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? Jeremiah made the proclamation in Jeremiah 32:17. Ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. The Lord came later in verse 27 and asked another rhetorical question after making a definitive statement of who he is. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Remember that faith matures during challenging circumstances. I said faith matures during challenging circumstances. Somebody said if I never had a problem, I would never know that God could solve them. So keep the faith. I recently saw several acronyms of the word faith. One I've used before, faith, forsaking all, I trust him. Faith, fully anticipating it to happen. And one that my mother introduced to us many months ago and is so applicable now, faith. Fear ain't in this house. Someone is asking about COVID-19. Is there a bomb in Gilead? And the answer is yes, but we have to keep the faith. And as we remember God's power, we will continue to pray to the Father, knowing that he has the power to heal, deliver, and set free. Praying to the Father, Ma, knowing that for this, whatever your this may be, that we have Jesus. And because I have Jesus, I have made it through my yesterdays. And because I have Jesus, I can make it through today. And because I have Jesus, I will make it through tomorrow, whatever tomorrow may bring. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. He is the same God who calmed the raging seas, who made the blind to see, the lame to walk, and the dumb to talk. He is the same God that had the power to speak to the winds and the waves, and the seas obeyed. He is the same God who parted the Red Sea and allowed Moses and the Israelites to walk across on dry land. And then he caused the sea to fold back and swallow the enemy up. He is the same God who raised Lazarus from the dead and the same God who raised Jesus from the dead. Can he fix it? Yes, he can. Can he heal it? Yes, he can. How do I know? Because I've seen him do it. So all we have to do is keep the faith. Now, after we work keeping the faith, remembering God's protection, his provision, his promises, and his power, we now have to remember to give God the praise. Philippians 4, 6 through 7 tells us, be careful, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. So when someone asks you, what is the reason for your peace? You tell them that my peace is in and because of the Lord, because of his love, his grace, and his mercy. What's the reason for my peace and therefore my praise? Because I know that God cares for me. But the problem is that sometimes when our spiritual vision isn't clear because it's fogged by our circumstances, we tend to focus on the wrong things and we ask the wrong questions. What if I get sick? What if I don't get or have what I need? What if this happens? Instead of focusing on the what if things, we need to focus on the whatsoever things. So finally, my brothers and my sisters, as verse 8 alludes to, after we have prayed, whatsoever things are true, God's word. Whatsoever things are honest, God is a man that he cannot lie. Whatsoever things are just, fair, rightly deserved, God is a just God. Whatsoever things are pure, uncontaminated by extra, unnecessary, and unclean things, God and his word are pure. Whatsoever things are lovely, desired, God is love. Whatsoever things are of good report, whose report will you believe? Somebody said, we shall believe the report of the Lord. So without this, we are nothing. And behind every whatsoever thing, you can simply put in God's name. For God is true, honest, just, pure, lovely, and definitely is of and has a good report. So the Bible says that if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Think on God. Think on the things of God. That is the reason for my peace, and that is the reason for my praise. My brothers and my sisters, I know that we can say without a shadow of a doubt that God is good. And sometimes we can get so caught up and focused on what isn't, on what's wrong, on the doom and gloom of what's going on around us, that we might neglect to praise God like we should. Everyone and anyone can praise God when things are going well. Praising God because of. But how many of us can praise God in spite of? How many of us can praise God through this pandemic? How many of us can praise God when things aren't going well? Someone said we don't have to wait until the battle is over. We can shout now. We don't have to wait to praise the Lord when he brings us out. We can praise the Lord until he brings us out. See, before this pandemic, some of us social distanced from each other at church on Sunday mornings. We clock watch hoping that church wouldn't be long. We've been here all day. The preacher is preaching too long. It don't take all of that. I got somewhere I need to be. Now that we are forced to shelter in place, forbidding gatherings of more than 10, some of us long for the church doors to be opened again. I can only imagine when God brings us through this, when the church doors open again. What a time, what a time, what a time. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. It's going to have a whole new different meaning. Entering into his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise is not going to mean the same. But until then, while we have to be isolated from each other for a moment, wherever you are this morning, I want you to take off your protective gloves and lift up your hands and praise the Lord. Take off your mask, open your mouth, and give God the praise. While you are disinfecting your physical house, don't forget to disinfect your spiritual house. Not with Lysol spray, because they ain't got no more in the store, no how. But disinfect with the Lord's Spirit up in your house. Wipe down the walls, the knobs, and the countertops of your heart. Not with Clorox, but with Christ. And while we have to shelter in place, place a little social distancing in your home if you live with someone. Get 6 feet away from others if you need to. Get to yourself and get your praise on. Get your step in. Our faith, do a little holy dance if you need to. Get your praise in. Ma, Pastor, Ma T, the Lord knows what you've been through. And for those who can't get a step in, just wave your hand or say thank you, Lord, for what you've done. Quarantine yourself in your room for a minute and give God some praise. For this is a personal thing. Some people have no idea of what you've been through. Folks ain't heard the prayers and things that you've uttered only to God. Folks haven't seen the tears that you've shed when no one was around. Folks don't know how you've almost given up. Folks really don't know how the Lord has kept you. But God, I said, but God, Reverend Hawkins, saints, praise God for his protection, his provision, his promises, and his power. Praise God for his healing touch. Minister Lucas, Wanda, and Chris Moody, Sister Sharon Daniel, and Nisi, God is still a miracle working God. Praise God for his keeping powers. Praise God for keeping food on your table, a roof over your head, and clothes on your back. Praise him for not allowing you through this pandemic to go plumb crazy and be out of your mind. Because God is worthy to be praised. Praise him for he is worthy to be praised. Despite whatever is going on around us, despite what our present circumstances may be, remember that God is good. Trouble don't last always. We're going to get through this with God and each other. So we just have to keep the faith, for this too shall pass. One person in the Bible who knew how to praise God no matter what was David. The entire book of Psalm is filled with his reverence and praises to God. In Psalm 8, O Lord, O Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Psalm 34, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Psalm 46, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Be still and know that I am God. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Psalm 48, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Psalm 63, O God, thou art my God, Reverend Hawkins. Early will I seek thee. My soul thirsteth for thee. My flesh longeth for thee in a dry and thirsty land where no water is, to see thy power and thy glory, so as I've seen in the sanctuary, because thy loving kindness is better than life. My lips shall praise thee. Psalm 103, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his name. Psalm 106, praise ye the Lord. Praise the Lord, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Psalm 107, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he redeemed from the hand of the enemy. Psalm 118, oh, give thanks to the Lord again, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. For I called the Lord in distress, and he answered me. Psalm 121, I will lift up mine eyes to the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. Psalm 126, the Lord hath done great things, whereof we are glad. And David ends with this last song, the 150th psalm of praise. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him for his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and harp. Praise him with the trembling dance. Praise him with the string instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. And until we can get back to the brick and mortar sanctuaries with our psalteries and harps, our string instruments and organs, our loud and high sounding cymbals, let us use our physical sanctuaries and shout with David in this last verse, let everything that hath breath praise ye the Lord. Why? Because he is our shepherd, our God, our rock in the weary land, our shelter in the time of storm. He is Jehovah. He is El Shaddai. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is our bread when we're hungry and our water when we're thirsty. He is our doctor in the sick room and our lawyer in the courtroom. He is the keeper of our minds, the sustainer of our souls, and the lifter of our heads. He is the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. He is the keeper of creation and the creator of us all. He is the architect of the universe. And though it may seem like right now, he's still got the whole world in his hands. He can, he shall, and he will, because he is able. He always was, always is, and always will be, unmoved, unchanged, undefeated, and never undone. The world couldn't understand him. The armies couldn't defeat him. The schools can't explain him, and the leaders can't ignore him. He is omniscient, omnipresent, and omnipotent. He is light, love, and he is Lord. He is good, gentle and gracious, righteous, redemptive, and reliable. God is merciful, mighty, and majestic. He is peaceful, powerful, and pure. He is immutable, immeasurable, and impeccable. His ways are right. His wisdom is rich, and his word is relevant. He is the God who changes not, but has the power to change any circumstances in his life. He has a balm for all our bruises, a solution for all our situations, an answer for all our anxieties, a peace for all our perplexities, and a deliverance for all our distresses. Corona ain't got nothing on Christ. Whatever you are going through is no match for an undefeated God. So while you're going through, as we close, remember to hold on. Remember God's protection, his provision, his promises, and his power. And whatever you do, remember to give God the praise. And now unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or even think, according to the power that worketh in us, unto him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end. Keep the faith. Amen, amen, and amen.
Let every heart pray. Father in heaven, we come. Thank you. Father, our hearts are full, and we certainly are blessed by your pouring out through our messenger on this morning. And Father, we know that your word is true in John 12:32. Jesus told us if he be lifted up, that you would draw all men to yourself. So we believe that spiritual formula has been done here. So we know that it is decision time. So Father, we pray now that someone has heard this message. Your son Jesus Christ has been lifted up, that you through your Holy Spirit would draw someone into a relationship with you. Lord, we thank you for this experience, and we give your name the praise. Amen, amen, and amen. Certainly, we are grateful for the message and the messenger, and we extend this opportunity for someone to make the decision about Jesus Christ and to surrender your life to him on today. It is simple. There's only two places that we go when we die. It is inevitable. Either we are going to spend eternity with God in his presence, or we're going to spend eternity separated from him, and the choice is ours. He has given us an opportunity to accept him, and if your heart has been pricked and you know that this is the day for you to surrender your life to him, we say do it now. Surrender your life to Christ. Give it over to him and allow him to make you new. So we ask that you would get down on your knees and to pray, and to ask the Lord to accept you, to confess your sins, and to admit that you are a sinner, and that you believe that his son Jesus Christ died for our sins, and stood in our place on the cross, and that you want to commit yourself to him and to his ways. That is all it takes. And then we ask that you would get with some Bible-believing and teaching church. Certainly the Word of God is a fine church to belong to. And if that is the way that the Lord is leading you, we certainly desire and want you. But we thank you for the decision that you have made. And if you have made it, we welcome you to our family, the family of Jesus Christ and the church. And I'm telling you, as one who has made that choice a long time ago, that I have not regretted making Jesus my Lord and my Savior. So we thank you for this time, and we surrender the rest of this service back into the hands of our Spirit. spiritual leader and worship leader, Reverend Roger Hawkins.
Amen. As we prepare ourselves, let us bow our heads and close our eyes as we talk to our Heavenly Father. Let us pray. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent is thy name in all the earth, who has set thy glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength because of thine enemies, that thou mightest steal the enemy and the avenger. When I consider thy heavens, the work of thy fingers, the moon and the stars, which thou hast ordained, what is man that thou art mindful of him? And the Son of Man, Lord, we thank you today. We come, Lord God, humble and grateful, thanking you for this day, for another chance to praise your holy and your righteous name. Lord God, as we find ourselves in a season of difficulties, Lord, as your servant David found himself in a life of a desert and dryness, Lord, we too are in a season of difficulties. And sometimes, Lord, negative circumstances can cloud our vision. Lord, we are not able to see clearly the direction in which we ought to go. And there are sometimes, Lord, that we even may think that our resources are even inadequate. But Heavenly Father, we have learned, because your word has told us, that if we hold to your hand, to the hand of the one who loves us, the one who cares for us, Lord, that you hold us with your right hand with an unseen power, Lord God, that we can still have joy. And Lord, even in negative circumstances, we can, like David, can find satisfaction, Lord. We can find joy, and we can find comfort in praising your holy and your righteous name. Oh, Heavenly Father, we come, and yes, Lord, we are concerned about COVID-19. We're concerned, but we pray today, Lord, that you would help us not to allow our concern to turn into worry. For Lord, certainly there are two things we cannot worry and trust you to. We're either going to worry or we're going to trust you. So, Father, we pray today that you would help us to trust you, Lord. And Lord, here at Word of God in particular, you have been preparing us for years as we've sat under sound doctrine, Lord, and immersed ourselves in this great doctrine called prayer. And Lord, and I'm sure there are other churches as well, but here at Word of God, Lord, you have prepared us, Lord, for such a time as this. So Father, we pray today that we don't waste the coronavirus, because it gives us an opportunity to reconnect with you, Lord, to draw closer to you, and for some to connect for the first time. For truly, Lord, you are speaking to the world right now, and your word has indicated to us that through the annals of time, many times you have used difficulties and hard times to draw people, to make them come to themselves and realize that you are God, and beside thee, there is no other. So, Lord, we ask that you help us to see beyond the physical, that we may see the spiritual ramifications of what is taking place in our lives today. For, Lord, you are our Father. We know that you are an awesome God, but we call you Father today because we are your children. And we know that you are a Father who cares for your children. For, Lord, you've told us that you know the plans that you have for us. Not plans to hurt or harm us, but plans to grow us, Lord, to prosper us, to give us an expected end, a future. And Lord, you even told us in your word that, beloved, it is your desire for us that we be in health and prosper as our souls prosper. So, Father God, even in these difficult circumstances, let us be like your servant David, Lord. Let us not go to sleep at night, Lord, and let our troubles consume us. But help us, Lord God, to discipline ourselves, to meditate on you and your word. And Lord, then we'll be able to praise you with joyful lips. For when we realize, just as David did, that your faithful love for us is better than life itself, Lord, we'll be able to continue to lift up your name, Lord. And as we go about everywhere we go, and Lord, not just for us, but you want us to encourage all persons that you may bless them through us. And so, Father, we come today saying thank you, Lord, and help us to remember also that this is just a temporary situation. And Lord God, as the preacher said, when it's all said and done, and we've come through this, Lord, we'll be able to give your name and only your name the praise and the glory and the honor that is due unto you. For Father, we are human and we have a tendency to forget. And for our people in particular, hard times is nothing new. Lord, you brought us through slavery. Lord, you brought us through segregation. Lord, you kept us through Jim Crowism. And even the continual injustice that we face on a day-by-day basis. And yet, Lord, we have not only survived, but we have thrived. And so, Lord, the only way that we're going to make it is that we hold to your unchanging hand. And realize, Lord, that we can and we shall overcome. And Lord God, when we sit down to talk about it, Lord, we'll realize as we can say that, yes, we've overcome by the blood of the Lamb. And we've overcome by our testimonies. Realizing, Lord God, that yes, you are real. And Lord, you are a God of all gods. And truly, Lord, you are still on the throne. And you're worthy to be praised. So family, let us hold fast to the faith that we profess. Let us keep our faith in these troubling times. Because, Lord, you even warned us, Lord. You told us that this trouble would come upon us. But be not troubled. For we shall experience famine and pestilence and wars and rumors of wars and all types of negative things, Lord. But be of good courage. For you have overcome, and because we are your children, we are heirs and joint heirs with your Son, the Christ, that we too shall overcome. And then, Lord, no matter the negative circumstances we face, to put our trust in you, for it's better to trust in you than to put confidence in man. And while man, the government, and the doctors are trying to figure it out, Lord God, you've already worked it out. And Lord, we, your children, have found the answer. Lord, we learn to pray. And so, Lord, we are going to do all the one another as you told us about. To call one another, to care for one another, to comfort one another, to connect with one another, to pray for one another as we call on your holy and your righteous name. In the mighty name of Christ, Lord, this is our prayer. And we say thank you, thank you, thank you. And every heart said amen, amen, amen.
We certainly thank God for how he has blessed us through our preacher of the hour, that of Reverend Melanie Gilliam. She taught us to remember God's protection, to remember God's promises, to remember God's power, and to remember to give God the praise. But for a brief moment, I would like to highlight her second point, which is to remember God's provision. She taught us that God has been good despite the chaos. Despite this season of trouble, God has to continue to provide for all of our needs. Indeed, God is still Jehovah Jireh, and God has already given provision for prayers that we have not even prayed yet. It's at this hour that we make our offertory appeal, and we ask that you do what God has already asked us to do in this written word. For he taught us that to be obedient is better than to sacrifice. We ask that you give 10% of your first fruits, and that you give according to how the Lord has already prospered you. We also remind you about the opportunity to use technology to give. Certainly, we can't make it out to the church edifice the way that we would like to, but we have the ability to give through PayPal. So you can go online, you can use your cell phone, or you can use your desktop, and you can go to the app. Type in the Word of God Baptist Church located in University Park, Maryland, and it will guide you through the process of how to pay online through PayPal. If you have any problems paying your tithes and offerings, you can contact one of our trustees. Sister Ivy Hawkins is our chair of trustees, and she will be more than happy to guide you through the process. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for providing for us. Lord, we thank you for teaching us about the spirit of giving. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. Lord, we know that you've already taught us that if we trust you with the 10%, that the remaining 90% will be blessed by you. So Heavenly Father, we ask that we be obedient to what you've already called us to do. Lord, we know you as a bridge over troubled water. We know you as our shelter in a time of storm. Many of us are struggling right now. Some of us got the pink slip this week. Some of us got the pink slip last week. And some of us don't know if we're going to have a job on next week. But one thing that we know is that you don't change. You're the same God from yesterday, the same God today, and the same God forever. So, Lord, the true test of our faith is, can we trust you in uncertainty? Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to give. We thank you for this opportunity to trust in you. We thank you for this opportunity to keep the faith through our giving, through our tithes, through our offerings. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And we say amen.
Certainly, we thank God for this great message. We thank God for our preachers. Keep the faith. Word of God members, we can see that we're in good hands. God has already provided for our future. And so, therefore, we are grateful. And when we look back over this situation this spring of 2020, we can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that God has, he has empowered our young people to move us through, and we can look back and thank God for our young ministers who have led the way during this dark hour. And so we thank God for Melanie. We thank God for all who have been a part of this great enterprise called the Word of God Church, and we can say that the best is yet to come. She's going to come now and give us our closing prayer and benediction.
Let us look to the Lord to be dismissed. May the grace of God, the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit, be with us all. In Jesus' name, amen.